हेलो हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज डॉक्टर पल्लवी गुप्ता। टुडे आई विल डिस्कस रोल ऑफ कंसेंट इन मेडिकल प्रैक्टिस। दिस इज द टॉपिक अंडर हेल्थ केयर लॉ। आई विल डिस्कस अंडर दिस टॉपिक द इंट्रोडक्शन और वी कैन से द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ कंसेंट इन मेडिकल प्रैक्टिस। नेसेसिटी फॉर कंसेंट, मीनिंग ऑफ कंसेंट, types of consent, the component of valid consent, legal or valid consent in medical practice, informed refusal, refusal to treatment, invalid consent, exceptions means where consent may not be obtained, some other important aspects regarding consent in medical practice. These subtopics will be discussed under this topic, the role of consent in medical practice. Introduction. Regarding consent in medical practice, this is not a new thing. From the very beginning, this concept is prevailed over there. Whenever patient approach to doctor or any medical practitioner, this element is always there. Nowadays there are several issues regarding consent. Medical practitioner or medical healthcare are not bothered about the consent of patient. So therefore several case laws are there, several theories are there to discuss the role of consent in medical practice. All kinds of medical treatment and surgical procedure involve interference with the human body. It is very clear to all. It may trespass to person done by assault, battery and false imprisonment. This is the wrong under law of torts. The relation between the doctor and patient is a fiduciary relation but type of contract. Fiduciary relationship means it is a relationship of trust where patient trusts on the doctors, but it is a type of contract. The consent, what is consent under law of torts? In fact, the tort of battery is defined as application of force of another person without lawful justification, and therein lies the essence of requirement of consent for medical treatment. Tort of assault is defined as every human being of adult years and sound mind has a right to determine what should be done with his body, and the surgeon who perform operation without the consent of the patient commit assault for which he is liable in damages. The principle is applicable not only to surgical operation but also to all form of medical treatment and to diagnostic procedure that involve intentional interference with the person, meaning thereby if there is interference with the body of human being without the consent of the patient, then it will be considered as a illegal interference. It may be battery, it may be assault. As in the case of Allen versus Newmont Sinai Hospital, this is a Canadian case. The anesthetist, the person who administered anesthesia, the anesthetist administered the anesthesia by injection into a vein in the patient in the left arm. The anesthesia leaked into the tissue of the arm as the needle slipped during the course of the operation. The patient suffered severe and unexpected reaction. but the doctor was not held liable in negligence on the ground that the occurrence of leakages of anesthesia into tissue of arm was recognized risk in the form of administration of anesthesia was the accepted professional practice. However, doctor was held liable in battery on the basis of evidence that the patient expressly prohibited the doctor from administering the anesthesia to her left arm. The principle enunciated in this case is that a doctor who proceeds to disregard the requirement of obtaining consent is strictly liable for any untoward consequences resulting from the procedural treatment. Even if he conform to the accepted medical practice, however, the decision of lower court was reversed on the ground that the plaintiff had not pleaded battery. The meaning thereby, although if you see this, the principle of battery says that application of force to the person of another without lawful justification, and there is lies the essence of requirement of consent for medical treatment. In the case of Ellen, there was anesthesia was administered into the left arm of the patient when she was refusing to do this. She was insisting the patient, the doctor, not to do. Even then, doctor has done it. But this remedy was not given because she has not pleaded the remedy under law of torts, that is known as a battery. Now, in the case of Melite versus Sulman, the patient's right of self-determination suggests that a competent adult is entitled to reject a specific treatment or all treatment, or to select an alternative form of treatment, even if the decision may entail risk as serious as death and may appear mistaken in the eye of medical profession. Means a patient is having a right not to accept the treatment even if it is a risky, even if there is a risk of his or her death. Now, what is the necessity of consent to be considered under the medical practices? As a part of duty of the doctor to take care of the patient, is required to explain to his patient what he intends to do and what are the implication involved, in a way in which a responsible doctor in similar circumstances would have done. And if there is a real risk of misfortune inherent in the procedure, the doctor's duty is to warn of the risk of such misfortune. In 1990, the court held in the case of Dr. Janaki S. Kumar versus Mrs. Sarafunsia, and the court held that the surgeon is the guilty of negligence if he conducted sterilization operation during cesarean section without obtaining the consent, particularly when there was no urgency for sterilization operation. Means there is no consent for sterilization operation and the case was of the cesarean. So how a doctor can do this? And the next case in the Samira Kohli versus Dr. Prabha Vanchanda, it is a very important case where the Supreme Court held that gynecologist is negligent for conducting hysterectomy and bilateral self-injo-operectomy, that is the removal of uterus, ovaries and fallopian tubes, without obtaining consent during laparoscopy test under general anesthesia for affirmative diagnosis. Means the treatment was for the diagnosis, and operation was done for the removal of the uterus, ovaries and fallopian tubes, that is considered as a as the negligence on the part of doctor, because she has not taken the consent for removal of these reproductive organs. Now let us understand the meaning of consent under law of contract. The term consent means it is a voluntary agreement, compliance or permission in medical practices. Consent is free consent. Consent should be free consent made by major, means adult person, with sound mind, no intoxication, without any fraud or undue influence or coercion. In section 13 says, when two or more person are said to consent, when they are agree on the same thing with the same sense, that is known as a consensus item, or we can say the meeting of the minds. When there is a meeting of mind on the same thing in the same manner between two person, it is said, it is called as a consent, and it should be free consent. It should not be vitiated by coercion, undue influence, fraud, like anything. There are two type of consent broadly, that is known as a implied consent. Implied consent most common type of consent in medical practices. It is apparent when it is shown by a conduct. It is apparent when a patient comes to hospital or doctor's clinic for treatment. Much of the physician work is done on the basis of this implied consent only, either by words or by behavior or by conduct, or the patient, or by the circumstances under which treatment is given. For example, it is common for a patient to arrange an appointment with the doctor or to keep the appointment, to volunteer the history, to the answer of the questions relating to the history, and to submit without objection to physical examination. In these circumstances, consent for the examination is clearly implied. Means when you are ready to answer the questions of the doctor relating to the history or for physical examination, this is by conduct or as per the circumstances a patient gives. An implied consent is a consent which is not written. That it exists, is not, existence is not expressly asserted, but nonetheless it is legally effective. There is no recorded document to prove the implied consent, but it has a legal sanctity as well. It is provided by the conduct of the patient and is by far the most common variety of consent in general sense, but not to procedure, which is more complex. Means when the procedure involves complexity, implied consent will not work. Regarding the express consent, it is written consent. Sometimes oral consent is also considered as a express consent, and informed consent is the extension of express consent. Express consent, it may be oral, written, or oral or written form in distinct and explicit language, clear cut. Express written consent is to be obtained for all major diagnostic procedure, general anesthesia, surgical operation, intimate examination for determining age, potency and virginity, and in medico-legal cases. There is always express consent. An express consent is one of the term of which are stated in a distinct and language. It may be oral or written. For the majority of relatively minor examination or therapeutic procedure, oral consent is employed, but this should preferably be obtained in presence of a disinterested party. Means when the patient is giving oral consent, there should be some evidence, witnesses. Oral consent where properly witnessed is a valid as written consent. But the written consent has the advantage of easy proof and permanent form. It should be obtained when the treatment is likely to be more than mildly painful and when it carries appreciable risk or when it will result in diminishing of a body function. Means when there is a procedural treatment, operation or complexity is there, then there is always a express consent. Consent may be confirmed and validated adequately by means of a suitable contemporaneous notation by the treating physician in the patient's record. Means the case history or the record of the patient, it shows about the written consent. It is prudent to obtain written consent also whenever analgesic, neurotic or anesthetic agents will significantly affect the patient's level of consciousness during the treatment. Means when the patient is not is in unconscious due to some narcotic or anesthesia, then written consent is always necessary. Valid consent in medical practice. Consent will be considered as a valid consent. There are three aspects that is known as a voluntariness, capacity and knowledge. Voluntariness. Patient should give consent completely voluntarily without any coercion, duress or undue influence. Means there should be a free consent. Consent obtained with compulsion either by the action or words of the doctor or others is no consent at all. Doctor have to ensure voluntariness of the consent. Means consent should always be come from the side of patient, not from the other side, except in exceptions. Capacity to consent. The patient should be in a position to understand the nature and implication of the proposed treatment, including its consequences or the risk. In this regard, the law requires several special consideration is of consent and mental incapacity. Age of consent means only a person who is a adult person, means minor cannot give the valid consent. The person who is a adult person means who is above the age of 18 in India can give valid consent for the treatment. Hence, any person who is a minor cannot give legally valid consent. Mental incapacity. It is well accepted that a person should be mentally capable to give consent for his or her own treatment. This implies that patients who are mentally retarded or mentally incapable due to any disease or alcohol or drunken may not be capable of giving their own consent. In such cases, consent from the legal guardian is essential. Knowledge forms the crux of the matter regarding the consent in medical practice. Means if this is a more important aspect, it include means a patient must have what is the nature of diagnosis, nature of treatment planned, foreseeable risk involved in the treatment. Means the knowledge, the information has been given by the doctor about this thing to the patient. Prognosis if treatment is not carried out, means if a patient refuse to go for treatment, what shall be the consequences, any alternative therapy available. So it is the duty of the doctor to disclose all these points to the patient so that patient may exercise a right to self-determination. About the proposed treatment. When questioned specifically by a patient about the risk involved in a particular treatment proposed, the doctor's duty is to answer this question with truthfulness, and fully answer should be given. Means doctor should not hide any of the fact. Legally valid consent for medical examination, meaning thereby there are situations when the consent shall be considered as a legally consent, legal consent or legally valid consent. Legally valid consent for medical examination, interventional procedure and treatment is one that is given by adult person himself, conscious and mentally sound. If the patient is less than 18 of the age or insane or unconscious, in such circumstances consent may be given by parents, guardian or close relative, that is known as substitute of proxy consent. Meaning thereby there should be consent by the adult person himself, or that should be the free consent, or it can be substitute of proxy consent when the person is not in a position to give consent. In that case, it can be given by guardian, parent. And next is informed express consent. Consent given before actually doing the procedure, not after, means it should be given before. Consent should be given in the presence of two witnesses. Consent should be freely, voluntary and directly. It should be signed by the doctor, valid by the doctor, patient or guardian and witnesses. It should be written in the patient's own language, means which he can understand, and it should be signed in his own handwriting. That in this situation, the consent will be considered as a valid consent or legally valid consent. Informed refusal. Nowadays, concept is in a fashion, we can say. Most of the time it is occurred. Refusal to treat means informed refusal. The doctor is having a duty towards the patient, meaning thereby the doctor is duty bound to disclose appropriately and adequately to the patient or the attendant the risk and possible consequence of not undertaking the treatment, diagnostic procedure, blood transfusion. Three things are there: treatment, diagnostic procedure or blood transfusion. Regarding these things, doctor is duty bound to disclose appropriately, adequately, and all the possible risks and consequences of not undertaking the treatment, diagnostic procedure or blood transfusion. After understanding about the procedure, its side effects and other information related to procedure, patient decline or refuse to undergo the procedure, it must be taken in written. This is the duty of the doctor if patient refuse to go for the treatment. Treatment cannot be forced upon any individual who does not want to receive it, except in a very few circumstances like issues associated with public health, military personnel or prisoners. Doctors are advised to avoid paternalism. Meaning thereby, if a doctor inform about all the risks, consequences involved in the treatment and all to the patient, and doctor also inform if patient refused to take the treatment, what shall be the consequences, and it is advised to doctor not to go for the not to show parental advice or parenteralism to the patient if patient refused to take the treatment. Now, the refusal of treatment, the patient has a right to control his or her body. Hence, any treatment without consent of the patient is actionable. Means patient is having a right to control his body. No treatment can be given without his consent. Any competent adult is entitled to reject any specific treatment offered to him, even if the decision may entail risk serious as death, and it may be wrong in the eye of medical profession. But adult patient is having a right to refuse the treatment. Invalid consent, there are certain situations when it will be considered as an invalid consent. If the act consented to is a unlawful, means a criminal abortion. Abortion is allowed under the law. If it is not, then it will be considered as a invalid consent. If this is done, the consent given by a minor or a mentally ill person, who is the person who is not in a position to give the position, means he is not having a capacity to give the consent, and consent is taken, then it will be considered as invalid. If it is not an informed consent, means risk and other consequences are not informed. If consent obtained by misrepresentation or fraud, if a consenting person is underage, means it is done by minor. There are certain exceptions where consent may not be obtained. There are situations known as a medical emergency, or sometime the consent of the guardian or parents are required, known as a proxy consent or surrogate decision maker and local parents. What are these things? We'll discuss. Generally, it is essential to obtain consent before any treatment is administered. However, there is an important exception to the rule, subject to certain conditions. In cases of emergency, a patient may be unable to give consent. In such cases, a substitute decision maker should be approached by the doctor. If such a person is not available, then it is the duty of the doctor to do what is essential to save the life of that person, even without consent. The next is for the doctor to declare any clinical situation as emergency for which consent is not required. There should be demonstrable imminent threat to the life or the health of the patient. It has to be proved by doctor. Under such emergency situation, the treatment should be limited to those steps which are necessary to deal with imminent threat to the life, limb or health. And fourth situation is the doctor must keep contemporaneous record, means all the record explaining such circumstances which force the doctor to act likewise. Next, if the circumstances are such that the urgency might be questionable later, arrange a second medical opinion would be prudent if it is possible to do so. Next condition is consent for extended treatment. Sometimes during an operation, it becomes essential to extend the surgery in the interest of the patient's health. At that particular moment, a substitute decision maker should be informed, and validity of the urgency of such a step should be well documented. Entirely unrelated surgery should not be undertaken unless it is essential to save the life of the patient. Meaning thereby, if there is a emergency, consent may not be obtained, but it is subject to certain conditions which I have discussed in the case of Ram Bihari Lal versus Dr. G. N. Srivastava in 1960, said the surgeon did not explain the hazard of chloroform anesthesia before taking consent of the patient. For operation of appendix, there was operation of appendix and the consent was not taken for the hazards which are involved in the giving of anesthesia. On finding the appendix to the normal, doctors proceeded to remove the gallbladder without consent and risking the ill effect of the patient under chloroform. In this case, the surgeon was negligent, meaning thereby the consent was given only to operate the appendix, and doctor performed the operation to remove the gallbladder as well. So this is the extended surgery in this case. For this, doctor was held liable. Locoparentis. In an emergency involved children, when their parents or guardian are not available, consent is taken from the person in charge of the child. That is, for example, a school teacher can give consent for treating a child who becomes sick during a picnic away from the hometown, but the consent of the headmaster of a residential school is perfect. Some other important points regarding the consent in medical practices. For compulsory vaccination, consent is provided by the law. If any person has donated his eye to be used for therapeutic purpose after his death, the eye can be removed only with the consent of the guardian of the legal heirs. For organ transplantation, the organ of the dead person should not be removed without the consent of the guardian of the legal heirs. Pathological autopsy should not be done without the consent of the guardian or legal heirs. In medical legal autopsy, which is a statutory authorization, consent is not required, and the doctor can remove from the cadaver anything that is essential for the purpose of examination. Consent is not a defense in cases of professional negligence. The nature of illness of a patient should not be disclosed to any third party without the consent of the patient. Consent of the spouse is not necessary for medical termination of the pregnancy. For contraceptive sterilization, consent of both husband and wife is always required. Meaning thereby, the consent is essential for any type of treatment or medical procedure or diagnostic procedure. Preferably, it should be taken in a written. It should always be in informed consent. Blanket consent has no legal value. So consent should be taken for a specific treatment or the procedure. Consent is must for medical legal examination with certain exceptions are always there. Consent provides a medical practitioner a legal protection in case of an action for negligence, although it is not a defense for professional negligence. Meaning thereby, consent must be free consent. There is a general format of the consent for medical legal consent. There are four part and three part there. Here it is mentioned that name of the person or the wife or daughter or the son of the and the residence, and like to give the full free voluntary consent for my complete medical legal examination. The purpose, nature and consequences of which has been explained by the doctor. The name of the doctor shall be mentioned there. And further, I certified no other medical legal examination has been done earlier anywhere else. They have to show like this. And all the injuries present on my body have been noted in the medical legal it is just a general format, it's not a specific one. It need to be specific. So this is all about consent, which I have discussed. In the next topic, I will discuss informed consent. Thank you for watching me. This is Dr. Pallavi Gupta. Thank you for watching me.